Well, let's see. Welcome, everybody. What I've got here for you today is we are going to make a power supply out of this little pill bottle. You've probably got hundreds of these things laying around, or at least you've thrown away hundreds of them. And, you know, I'm just going to... I've obfuscated everything, because I know there are people who actually go frame by frame and look for stuff. But, first of all, I want to go through, before I explain all that, I want to go through what came in the mail today. Which, of course, this is really great. Okay. The other day, I said that my STM32 had come in. And indeed it has. It's this little guy. There's a breakout board. This thing just looks too cool not to play with, right? This is a, it's still in the wrapper here, but an STM32 F030 demo board. This is a Cortex M0 Core 32-bit 48 megahertz board. And it's just got tons of analog and digital stuff on it, and a micro USB on the side. So, there's a bunch of cool stuff that this does, but to program it, it has a 8-pin in two 4-pin headers bent to the side, you know, so it's the same direction here, and this little guy is the programmer for it. This little guy, it comes with headers and everything. They sell, this is from ST-Link itself, and they're like $295 for these little guys. And it's got the jumper and everything. They come in different colors. Can't wait to play with that. So, more STM32 stuff coming, and as I think I mentioned when the first board came in, the great thing about these is that they are supported by the Arduino IDE. So if you didn't want to have to go to Eclipse or anything, there's no problem. You can actually use the regular IDE that you're used to. Anyway, so cool. What else came on my slow boat? This is... not sure what this is. Ah, yes. Some more project boards. Going to be moving a couple of my sensors over. And I prefer, I guess I'm old school, I prefer the ones where each one of the holes in the template are simply rimmed or circled in copper without all the lines that you have to worry about grinding and everything. I typically keep things kind of compact anyway, so I'm not too worried about it. These are going to come in handy. Okay, moving on. We're going to make a pill bottle power supply. This little guy is a board prototype of one of my weather sensors, and it has a BM280 logic converter from 3.5 to 5, a nano running at 5 off of here, and this is one of my kind of edgy junk off the run NRF24s, and I'm noticing that my NRFs are getting very intermittent, and I think the reason is this one's not even running on a power you know, on a regulator. It's got that wacky little splitter. And rather than me, you know, have to throw a regulator in there and everything to go from 5 volts down, because I'm thinking of running some tricks anyway with it, what I'm going to do here is I'm going to try to put another, this bus here is 3 volts, this is 5 over here. I'm going to try a dedicated 3.3 power supply in here. I have a power supply, like a ATX case power supply project that I'm going to be doing here in about a week. that will let me, I've got some boxes and stuff in the back where I can, you know, break everything out, put my banana plug jacks on the side. Look really cool. Won't even show that to you now. This is a quick. But anyway, I'm hoping that once I hook up the regulated 3.3, at least a lot more juice, then the NRF, which is a power bitch anyway, will be a little nicer to the nano configuration there. So, with that in mind, let's talk about what this is going to involve. The first thing is one of these little 59-cent... Really, I just want to use it. I just want to see. I could have done this another way. I've got a ton of regulators, 7905s, TO220s, to go to 5 and 3.3, but they're very inefficient, and they're kind of not even this generation. This little guy, 95% is what they claim for the efficiency, and it's a buck down converter with a 1.5 meg switching rate. So I'm going to open this little guy up. These aren't even branded, but I went through and looked up the chips. What the main business chip here, what do I want to point with? How about this? Oh, okay. Well, that just washed everything completely out. All right, great. Okay. Right here, this chip, which you'll see in the middle of these, and common problem with these cameras. This little guy right here is a Monolithic Power Systems MP1584EN. MP1584EN. And that's the meat and potatoes of everything. Why in the God's name doesn't this thing ever focus? Do I have to give it light from this angle, maybe? Maybe that's what it likes. Yeah, there we go. Well, had it. Come on, baby. That's the big regulator. This is the down converter itself. Not even sure what this guy is. I think it might even be a crystal for the 1.5 gigs. Come on. Don't be afraid. Oh my goodness. You know? SS, you can make that out. SS34. Trust me, I went through all these chips to find out which one it was. So, little tiny thing. If I had to do a here's a comparison. This little guy is in inches, half-inch squares, so it's 1 inch, less than an inch, by less than 3/4 of an inch. You can see that. Each one of these lines is half an inch. So that's not bad. So, that's our first little guy. Second, I'm going to use at least one 10 microfarad electrolytic to help with the burst, the surge of juice here, because I don't expect this buck down converter to be very fast in response. I'm going to use an LED, which I'll save you the trouble of watching me do. I've already put a 1K on the end of it. I'm going to use this little LED, and I'm going to pop that through the top of this so, you know, I can see if there's power on the output. This chip board is configured like this. So it's got four little connections in, out. Very simple. So I kind of spaced it a little bit to where it would need to be. The 1K and everything, it's already there. Pill bottle. Like I said, you got millions of these things. I have saved you the trouble by drilling all four holes. Now, the reason I have four holes is one is going to be for the power wire coming in, and one is going to be for the LED. The other two tiny holes are going to be for, I'm really doing this inelegantly because I want to be able to use it on the breadboard. I'm just taking a couple of, geez, what are these? Can't be more than 8, right? Yep, they're 8 inches. 2 8-inch DuPont jumpers, the kind I don't like because they have the square non-molded ends on them that slip. And finally, a USB cable. Again, I'm saving you the trouble because I've already cannibalized this thing. I chopped off the business end. I forget what this is called, what that connector's called. And I stripped and tinned the ground and positive. And I'm getting on the meter here about 5.2 volts off of this little POC, which is 5 volts, 1,000 milliamps, so 1 amp. I'm sure if I had a better one, it would output more. So, that's it. And I've done, like I said, all the menial stuff has been done already. So, first things first. In electronics, we have one thing that can always screw you up, and that is when you don't put your wires through the cap container collar, the clamp at the end of a connector, anything like that, from the military ones to civilian ones, they are, that's the pain. Because what ends up happening is, right, you solder everything together and you go, oops, I forgot the connector thingy. So what I like to do first, and that's why I tinned all these and got them ready, is I like to put that in first. So what we're going to do, and we'll take care of strain relief too. These two holes are the same. So I'm going to take all of my leads from my USB. I've saved D plus, D minus, and made them a little bit shorter so they don't have a problem, you know, shorting or anything. I've kept the shield to ground. That's what you see here, the silver braid. Again, cut it shorter, so it's not going to be as long as these two. And tinned after bringing out about a quarter of an inch of, after taking out about a quarter of an inch off of these, red and black, and tinned them so they're completely ready to go. So what I think I'll do here is, looking at this, right, knowing I can make it as long as I like, I think what I'm going to do here is just put my little knot in for my strain relief and, you know, give it some room. It's got tons in there. And this will provide all the strain relief I need from somebody pulling on this. Okay? Next, I think next, before things get too complicated in here, I'm going to affix the LED, but I think I should put this on the board now. Something tells me I should put it on the board because if I have this guy in and heat gunned, glue gunned in, and then I try to solder it to the board, I got a feeling it's going to be more difficult. So why don't I hold off on putting the LED on until the LED is completely... would it help if I did it like this? Can you see better? Oh, yeah, you can see a lot better this way. I'll wait to put this guy on until the end. And I'm even going to be putting one of these caps on here, and I really should have thought this through and done this one and put this right on here before we started. So, first things first, let me make sure that I have my LED working. I haven't even tested it yet. So, we're going to test the LED real fast. Okay, so I just plugged in the power supply. And I've left the the resistor is on negative. Okay, so there's my LED. So the resistor's on negative. I just won't mess anything up. I'll unplug this. So what I'd want to do here is actually really, before I get too far, is I want to go ahead and put one of these on here, because I do want to get this on the board. And this little guy, remember I said it has a total of 8 holes that we can use. You can see maybe a little easier. Ins on this side, outs on this side, 2, 2, 2, and 2. So I figure my LED and everything are going to use one pair, just because I want to do it neater. And the output is going to be through these two jumper DuPont cables on the other two. Keep things kind of, more compact and not trying to cram everything onto one. So the negative, I want to go on here, and we try to, back in electronics school, it was always to form a good physical connection, which would always give you the potential for a good solder connection. And boy, would we get our butts reamed for making cold solder joints that would just fall apart. So, I'm just going to crimp this guy together. I should have done this before. I was just trying to get started with the video before it got too late, and I didn't. And so now I've got to make up for all this by, unfortunately, making you watch me solder a capacitor. So I'm very sorry about that. I wanted this to be a bit faster. And if this ends up being so painful, then I can just trim the video. Okay. Real fast. Not even going to go crazy here. Just going to go ahead and just do it without even the magnifier or nothing. Just push it down. Oh, baby. I didn't unplug this, did I? No. There we go. One. Lead number, nope, come back. Lead number 2. Okay. Take our little guy. Clip off the extra. This is going to be across the output. Now, I'm actually putting this capacitor on the leads of this LED. I am doing it before the resistor, so it is going to be on the board itself. The reason I'm doing that is I just have this thing. I just don't feel like applying the capacitor to these leads, the output leads, is a good idea. And here's where we are right now. So let's call this the in, this is the out. I'm putting the, let's call this plus, minus. I'm putting the electrolytic here. Oh, jeez. On the inside pair, where the LED is going to be, with the resistor. This is going to be the two leads, these two DuPonts. This guy coming in, all that I'm going to have there, because I'm not going to put any meters or anything on it, is going to be our USB over here. Okay, so next what I'm going to do to get ready for that is to get these DuPont jumpers ready. Now, I chose these because A, I don't like them. These square ones I don't like, so I want to get rid of them in any way I can. And two, unlike the molded ones, you can actually take the plastic part off of here very easily. And if you use these, they come off way too easily. And that gives me a nice pin to use, right? The pin that would normally have been, a 20 gauge that would normally go into the breadboard itself. And I can use that in the holes to solder, and gives me a really good, fits like a glove, mechanical connection. Now the way I did this is, and I saved one of them, the way I did this is, on these DuPonts, there is a latch on the... There's a latch where you see the metal. Now... There's always a spot that you can see the metal, see it facing up, and then three of the sides don't have anything. The one with the metal is the one where you want to pry up that little plastic thing, like that. See how now I pried it up? And this guy will just slide right off, just like that. Okay, really easy. It leaves this nice bare end. We're going to use this end for, you know, connecting the power supply itself. So, I got two of them like that. These are the easiest to put through the cap now. So I will. I've made two tiny little holes here. You can barely see them. When I stick the wire through, it'll kind of make sense. Oh, boy, they just go in there. Barely. Here we go. And I want to make some strain relief on these, but I think the way that I'll do this is a little different. I think what I'll do is I'll just simply tie them in one knot, and then I'll glue them, you know, toward the cap there where they go out. So this gives me plenty of room to get on the outputs of my little critter here, and that's going to be on the outside. This little arrangement is going to be on the inside. So now's a good time, because this input I can just put wherever. I'm going to actually end up seeing, and there's an arrow. You can see a little arrow. I'm going to actually have this sort of sitting, although it could sit any way it wants, it's so small, so that the output is generally speaking toward the top. And that's because my LED is going to be on the top as well, right? Because it's going to be sticking out the hole. So let's go ahead and attach the LED. And our negative out is here on this side. And I think we'll come in from the back. That way we keep the front nice and clean. Just, well, I don't know, just one of those things, right? I always have these weird, you know, if you get a chance to do it one way or the other, I always seem to remember from school and from working it on benches, I always seem to remember that there was always a preference, you know? There was always a, well, if you could do it this way or that way, always do it this way. See, you have a choice, but don't take that choice. So I'm going to stick them in from the bottom. I'm going to bend them over. Remember, Mr. Lair would always tell us, make a good physical connection before you even consider making a solder connection. Use our handy dandy. Where's a good place to grab this? Not where there are chips. There we go. And I don't want to mess this up, so I'm going to use the magnifier. And I'm going to do the negative first, because it's farthest away. And the easy one last. There we go. Is that, hold it still. Perfect. Once again, we do a clip. And can't even get to this one. Maybe a little bit. There we go. Now, as it is, just throw it in there. I think it'll be fine. This little LED will fit through this little hole like that. See it? Right there. It's going to sit through the hole. Right there. And this little guy will, you know, it's got enough wire here. It can bend whichever way it needs to. Okay. My leads. These aren't going to come out this way because of the, well, they might because of how crappy those connections are. But I've got them in a knot here for this end. So maybe it's a good time now to get these on. Again, I want to put the LED through the hole last because that's really going to give me the least amount of leverage and room to do anything else. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to put these guys through same exact way, out plus. And remember, I'm using the outer two now. The inner two were for the LED. Now I'm using the outer two. These represent the DuPonts. And let's do it. Let's take the negative here, positive there. Just like before, they're sticking straight out. In this case, I will bend outward. I don't like bending everything in the same direction. If I have a chance, bend the inside ones this way, bend the outside ones that way. You do whatever you like. That's just my force of habit. Okay. On she goes. Quick, quick, quick. Again, I'm trying not to make this last forever. Maybe I'm too late. Watching somebody solder is like watching grass grow, right? Okay, so outputs are done. That's it. I wish I could show you through the magnifier. So the outputs are done. Ready to go. They will come out of the pill bottle, and I'll have these two nice little guys to put into breadboard or whatever I want to do. Mostly breadboard. I'm just using a pill bottle so it's not, you know, exposed connectors. And I'd say, if we wanted to really finish this guy up before putting the LED in, what I'm afraid of is, if I put the LED in with the glue gun and stuff, and I go to put these input connectors with the 5 volts on them, I'm afraid that it's going to break off either the connectors, or it's going to make the glue go sideways or something. So I think it's better if I just make all the connections to this circuit board before putting the LED in and gluing it. Like, make that last. So everything will be complete, ready to go. All that's left is to pop the LED through and then secure the various connections with a heap of hot glue, which is over here on the side. Whoops. With those little circuit boards I got. Put them right next to the gun. All right, so let's do exactly that. We have our strain relief because of this nice little knot here. It's really great that light just makes things so hard to see. So I've got the strain relief here. Oh yeah, that looks a little better, doesn't it? The strain relief of the red and the black wires, you can see them coming straight through the cap. See them? And the last hole, this little guy here, is where the LED is going to go through. So we're looking at the bottom. This is the top. Okay. So, easy enough. Let's take these guys here. And it doesn't matter which I connect to over here. But again, if you have a choice, always start with the inside ones because it makes testing with a meter easier for the outside ones. So, again, it's one of those, I'm just used to doing things when it was all the military and you had to do it this way or that. You really started to find ways to make your life easier later on. It's the easiest way to put it. I guess after you screw things up enough, maybe that's it. The secret is, mess things up like crazy, and then you'll get instinctively how to do things so they don't get messed up. just going to clip that guy into one of our existing connections. My red looks really good, but the black, for whatever reason, because of the angle of this, my negative has been shoved up through the hole. So what I'm going to do is the positive first. These are very, very small braided wires, so I really don't want to overheat these, because it's just so fast that you can burn right through a piece of wire. And just, like, literally burn through it. Like, the braid and everything just goes away. So now I can put some pressure on this to pull it down a little. Come on. I want that metal connector right on like that. Maybe I'll put a little weight like that on it. There we go. Perfect. I believe it's the last soldering, so you don't have to put up with much more of this. In and out, nice and quick. Here we go. Trim those leads. I could probably just bend them off. They're so small. That's another really great reason to have the strain relief. You know, it has this massive USB cable, right? But inside it are four or five, if you count the shield, very, very small wires. I don't know if you can even see how small those are, but they are super duper tiny. And you're like, 5 volts, 1 amp?
Are you serious? Right? Look at the difference in the thickness. All right.
Now we're ready, the fun part. Should we test before we do the assembly? Probably should. Let's take our USB. If I did everything right, which I may have, because the input leads aren't labeled for positive and negative, then either we'll get a pop and a puff of smoke, or we will see this LED come on. Hey! Well, we could have gotten both, I guess. But there's our little LED. Can you see it lit? I don't know. It's really weird trying to get the lighting in here to work right. I could have put a little switch on the side. I have these little toggle switches, 100 of them, but I thought it was kind of hokey for this, you know? It's just a stupid little, you know, thing. Excellent. So, look at that. Look how that's all coming together. A really weird-looking mess. Now, I do have a shield here that is exposed, and normally I would keep the shield and I would glue it or something, but I'm not coming back to this, so I'm going to cut this shield off because I'm afraid it will short something. Even if we're trying to keep these wires from twisting and changing the orientation of the board, I just, you know, you just don't want any problems. Just don't want any problems. So, generally speaking, the heavier wire gives you the most grief. So, if I leave the heaviest wire for last, it has the ability to break off the connections of everything else. So, what I'll do here is pull it nice and tight, and keeping it away from where it has to close, because this little guy still has to get in inside that ring, I'm going to hope that I can get enough in here to make it stay without melting everything. And I got to check. Sure enough, a bit much. So, what I'll do is
still sticky on the outside here. You never have what you need. Get some of that off of there. Pull that in a little bit. Now I'm going to take the other two components, if I can get them to just bend a little bit. It's kind of tight, a little tighter than I wanted it. There we go, that gets the red and the black lead, the output leads. Gonna put a little on that LED, get that little guy. Only takes a little bit. Pull the LED out a little. There we go. And there we have it. Simple. Plug her back in. Fingers crossed. There you go. The glue's coming out here, so the heaviest wire, the one I was worried about most, is secured. And let's see what we have on the output, which I should have probably calibrated it before I did this. May have to take it apart, do it again, but the factory 3.3, and I have 3.7 something. So I'm actually happy about that. And I know that I can turn it down counterclockwise. So if I could find me a screwdriver nice and quick. Gotta hurry because the glue is drying. So forgive my rush. There you go. I want to get this set fast with the adjustment pot that's in it. These clip-ons make this so much easier. And a screwdriver. Clockwise is more, counterclockwise is less. Slightly different size. How about this guy? Still too big? I can fudge it. I can fudge it with something like that. Here we go. There we go. Oh, the right's going down, actually. Oh, isn't that weird? Oh, is that touchy? I'm leaving it there, 3.49. There we go. Yeah, I'm leaving it 3. Can you see that? 3. Try to make it so you can without the glare. So that's our guy. I should have thought about that. Oh, I was in so much of a rush for the video. Okay, one other small thing that that I picked up in the military is when you have leads like this, and they're exposed at the end, I even do this on the jump starter that I have for my car, you know, the battery inverter. What we try to do is we try to make it so one is not the same length as the other, because we don't want to just lay it down and have these two touch each other. I know it sounds weird, when would that ever happen, but so what I like to do is take one of them, maybe the ground, and you know, nice and close to the top of the lid, I just make a nice little knot, you know, something like that, no big deal. Now, when they lay together, one's not going to short the other. And that's it for the video. Pretty cool. Very simple. It's nothing earth-shaking, but this is the first time I used this this little buck converter. And looking at how sensitive it was, you know, to the adjustment, I mean, it was very sensitive. Like a crappy resistor they ship with. It's like one of those pieces of film, and you turn a metal, if I could show it to you, turn a metal piece, and all it's doing is there's a little connector on the actual graphite. So, you know, you're basically, you just touch it the wrong way, just a tiny little bit, and it jumps up a volt. So, regulation? I don't know. I'll leave that to testing. But that is how you can use the Monolithic Power Systems MP1584EN buck down converter. It will take 4.5 to 28 volts. We said we were feeding it with 5.3, was it? I think it was 5.3. 4.5 to 28, and puts out a maximum of 3 amps. At 3.3 is where I was, because I adjusted it to 3.3. There's just no way those little wires were gonna do, you know, an amp. So there's no risk of us pulling 3 amps off of this, because we're not giving it an amp. We're not giving it 3 amps. And even at 5 volts, I mean, it doesn't work out like that. And didn't really have a chance to see the inefficiencies of it or anything, but generally speaking, kind of a neat little 5-minute project. I seem to just need power all the time, in different places, different ways. So, I will leave you, and I will leave you with me labeling this with the voltage, because that's going to be the most important thing for us to remember with this. So, if you end up doing a neat little project like this, or you think of a better way to do this, then let me know. Maybe we can make another one in a different kind of container, or maybe using some of those regulators I've got hundreds of. But there you go. So we got a nice little 3.3. If you can see, it's a crappy little whatever. Thanks, guys. That's it. Till next time.